Hare Krishna. Thank you very much, Prithivala Sinimataji, for this opportunity to serve all of you. Om Jnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmay Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtham Thapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Gadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajata Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Pada Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Namaum Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Nitinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Namaum Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Tinamine Shri Varshabhanavi Devi Daitaya Kripabhaye Krishna Sambandha Vidyana Daine Prabhave Namaha Madhuryojvala Premadhyaya Shri Rupanuga Bhaktida Shri Gaura Karuna Shakti Vigrahaya Namostute Namaste Gauravani Shri Murtaye Dinatarine Rupanuga Virudhapa Siddhanta Dvantaharine Namo Gaura Kishoraya Sakshad Vairagya Murtaye Vipralambha Rasambodhe Padambujaya Te Namaha Namo Bhakti Vinodaya Sachidananda Namine Gaura Shakti Swarupaya Rupanuga Varayate Gaura Virbhava Bhumestvam Nirdeshta Sajjana Priya Vaishnava Sarvabhavama Shri Jagannathaya Te Namaha Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaura Tise Namaha Pancha Tattvatmakam Krishnam Bhakta Rupa Swarupakam Bhakta Avataram Bhakta Akhyam Namami Bhakta Shaktikam हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगतपते गोपेशा गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते जयताम सुरतो पंगोर मम मंदा मतेर्गति मत सर्वस्वा पदाम्बोजो राधा मदन मोहनो दिव्य वृंदारण्य कल्पद्रुमाद श्रीमद् रत्नागर सिंहासनस्थौ श्रीमद् राधा श्रील गोविंद देवौ श्रेष्ठानिधि सेव्यमानौ स्मरामि श्रीमान् रास रसारम्भि वंशीवता ततस्थिता कर्षण वेणु स्वनैर गोपिर् गोपीनाथाय श्रीयेस्तु नः सप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानु सुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवास आदि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे
Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Govinda Dwarka Vasin, Krishna Gopi Janapriya, Kauravair Paribhutanma, Kim na jana si Keshava, He Natha He Rama Natha, Vrajanatha Artinashanam, Kauravair Navabhugnanma, Uddharasva Janardana, Krishna Krishna Mahayogin, Vishwatman Vishwabhavana, Prapannam Pahi Govinda, Guru Madhe Vashidatin. Hare Krishna. We are at a very, very auspicious time of the year. We just celebrated Shri Krishna Janmashtami. Yesterday was the divine appearance day of our founder and Acharya, His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada. Yesterday was also Nandotsav, the day Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Mai in Gokul Vrindavan celebrated the appearance of Krishna in their life and in Vraja. And today is the auspicious day of Ekadashi. So I am very grateful to have received this opportunity to serve all of you by discussing some Krishna Katha. Thank you very much. Dasosmi. Please bless me so that I am able to glorify Krishna and Srila Prabhupada in such a way that our hearts become purified and our hearts become attracted to humble service at the lotus feet of Srila Prabhupada and Sri Krishna. We read in the famous itihas called Mahabharata, which was authored by Srila Vyasadeva himself. He dictated Mahabharata, which is more than 100,000 beautiful Sanskrit verses. And Sri Ganesh ji, the illustrious son of Lord Shiva and Mother Parvati Devi, Ganesh ji wrote down as Srila Vyasadeva spoke. Vyasadeva is an incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna. And Ganesh ji is the expansion of the foremost devotee of Krishna, Shivji. So this beautiful itihas, Mahabharata, which is also called as the fifth Veda. There are the main four Vedas, Samaved, Yajurved, Rigved and Atharvaved. And the fifth Veda is called Mahabharata. And within this Mahabharata, there is Gita Upanishad. There is this Upanishad called Bhagavad Gita, the song of Bhagavan Shri Krishna. So certainly Mahabharata is a very important shastra, very important scripture. And in this Mahabharata, it is the history of India is described. The history of the great personalities who appeared in India in the ancient times, thousands of years ago, is narrated. There is a great dynasty of King Kuru, and his descendants were called the Kurus. And Dhritarashtra, Pandu and Vidur were three brothers born in this dynasty. And Dhritarashtra was the eldest, and next came Pandu, and youngest was Vidur. Vidur was begotten from the womb of a servant, so he was not qualified to be the king. Dhritarashtra was not qualified, although he was the eldest, because he was blind physically. And Pandu was the most qualified, so he became the king, but he was not attached to the kingdom. So after establishing a wonderful kingdom, he put Dhritarashtra in charge temporarily, and for some time he decided to go and live a simple life of an ascetic in the forest with his two wives, Kunti and Madri. And there they had five sons from the demigods. Yudhishthir Maharaj was born from Yamraj. Bhim was born from Vayudev. Arjun was born from Indradev. And the two Ashwini Kumaras gave birth to the twins, Nakul and Sahadev. So in this were the five illustrious sons of Kunti and Pandu were born in the forest. It's a long story. And at the same time, Dhritarashtra's wife, Gandhari, she became pregnant, and she was envious of Kunti. She wanted to give birth before Kunti gave birth so that her son would be the eldest heir to the throne and would become the next king naturally. So she was very envious of Kunti, and therefore she wanted to give birth to her son before Kunti did. But Kunti gave birth to Yudhishthir Maharaj before, and therefore she became very upset and she started hitting her own womb. And again, it's a long story, we don't have time. So anyway, Duryodhan, Dushasan and 98 other sons, total 100 sons were born to her. And Dhritarashtra was partial towards his biological sons, his 100 sons, the Kauravas. And although the five sons of Kunti and Pandu were more qualified to inherit the throne, he created many hurdles and obstacles on the path of the Pandavas. Not only that, Dhritarashtra, being swayed by the evil schemes of his eldest son, Duryodhan, even tried to kill the five Pandavas. Not killing them with a fair fight, because they knew that the five Pandavas are very strong and very talented. It is not possible to defeat them in a fair fight. So Duryodhan resorted to unfair tactics. After Pandu died in the forest, Mother Madri decided to go and enter the funeral pyre with Pandu so that she could continue to serve him and attain the same destination. Mother Kunti also wanted to join, but there were five young children. So Mother Kunti, being the elder, decided to take the harder road the road of not being reunited with her husband and attaining the same heavenly destination as her husband, but the road of staying back in the material world as a widow without any shelter and raising these five sons. She was extra affectionate to Nakul and Sahadev, knowing that their biological mother, Madri, had left this world along with Pandu. So in this way, Kunti, she lived for some time in the mountains, in the Himalayas, when the sages told her that now you should return to Hastinapur. She came back, and ever since she came back, Duryodhan and his brothers were very envious of them. And Dhritarashtra was unfairly partial towards Duryodhan. When Duryodhan was 10 years old, he devised a scheme to get rid of the strongest of the five Pandavas, Bhimsen. He gave him poisoned food in the hope to kill him. Is that a fair tactic? You are poisoning the food without the person's knowledge and trying to kill. They did that. But again, it did not work. Because Rakhe Krishna Mare Ke, Mare Krishna Rakhe Ke. If Krishna wants to protect somebody, nobody can destroy that person. And if Krishna wants to destroy somebody, nobody can protect that person. And Krishna always protects his devotees. Therefore, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Avashya Rakhibe Krishna. Krishna will definitely protect. There is no doubt. Krishna will definitely protect his devotees. Avashya Rakhibe Krishna. Rakhe Krishna Mare Ke, Mare Krishna Rakhe Ke. So Bhim was protected because they were all pure devotees. All the five brothers in their previous births, they were Indra in different universes. And they were very devoted to the service of Shri Krishna, especially Arjun. And then, few years later, Dhritarashtra called Kunti and Yudhishthira and told them, my dear sister-in-law and my dear nephew, I have constructed a special house for you in the forest. Please go and for my satisfaction live in that house for a few days. I have specially constructed it for your enjoyment. Actually, this was a house made up of lac. It was very flammable. And Duryodhan and Dhritarashtra planned to burn to death the five Pandavas and their mother Kunti in their sleep. This was their evil plan. Again, is this a fair war? Is this a fair fight where you are killing somebody when they are asleep? Without their knowledge, you are setting the house in which they are taking rest on fire. And you have constructed that house. And as an elder, you are ordering them to go and live in that house because that house is a gift as a vacation home from you to them, and then you plan to burn them to death when they sleep there. Five young boys and their mother. This is how evil Duryodhan, Dushasan and their father Dhritarashtra were. But Vidur is an incarnation of Yamraj. He was always very righteous. He always knew what is dharma. So he sent a secret coded message to Yudhishthira Maharaj, which Yudhishthira Maharaj easily understood and came to know what the evil plans were. So Bhim dug a tunnel, underground tunnel from the house through which they escaped. And when the house was set on fire, they escaped unscathed. And Duryodhan falsely thought that their plan was successful. And the five Pandava brother and their old mother had been removed permanently from the scene. And now there was no one there to oppose him. This was his evil scheme. So the Pandavas, they survived this attack, and then they didn't know what to do because Duryodhan had a big army. His father was the emperor. So they were just living in the forest, And then they came to know by the mercy of Vyasdeva that the king of Drupad is conducting a swayamvar for his beautiful daughter called Draupadi, who was born not a material birth, but who was born from yajna. She was born from fire, and she was an expansion of the goddess of fortune herself. That was Draupadi. Because Draupadi was so divinely qualified, because she was a perfect woman, her father, Drupad Maharaj, arranged for a Swayamvar ceremony. Swayamvar means you yourself choose your var, your husband. And only someone who is divinely qualified, like Mother Sita, can do that. Swayamvar is not for any ordinary lady. It is for lady who is extraordinary. And Draupadi was extraordinary. She was an expansion of Mother Lakshmi Devi herself, who had appeared on this earth to assist her beloved Lord Shri Krishna in the mission of relieving this earth of the excessive burden of Kshatriya and assisting Krishna in his pastimes. She had appeared. So then Arjun went and he won the Swayamvar ceremony, and then he brought back the Srimati Draupadi Devi to the house of the potter where they were living in seclusion. And by divine arrangement, Mother Kunti spoke that please share whatever you have brought equally amongst each other. And then Vyasdeva himself appeared there and he said that whatever Mother Kunti has spoken is by divine arrangement. Because Srimati Draupadi Devi in her previous life had prayed to Shivji. 5 times she had prayed that please give me an extraordinary husband. 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 And that 5 times she had prayed very earnestly to Shivji. But Shivji is Ashutosh. She is very easily pleased. When she asked first time, he granted it. Second time granted it. So then he said, you will have 5 husbands in your next birth. And they will all be incarnations of Indradev himself. They are Indra. They have been held the post of Indra at some university. They were very qualified and they will be pure devotees of the worshipable Lord Krishna. And by serving them, you will serve Krishna in his mission. So Vyasdev said that by the arrangement of Shivji, this marriage, which is very atypical, which is very unusual, is Vedically 100% bona fide and sanctioned. This is the destiny, that Draupadi will have these 5 husbands. And then Vyasdeva, based on scriptures, he tells historical evidences that yes, there was a rishi in the past, and he had a daughter and she was married to 5 other rishis. So this is not unheard of. It is mentioned in the scriptures. And then Vyasdeva gives the example of the famous Prachetas also. The Prachetas also had only 1 wife. So in this way, the marriage was sanctioned and Draupadi legally got married to the 5 brothers, Pandavas, and she dutifully served them equally. And at that time in the forest, Kunti, the 5 Pandavas and Draupadi were living very peacefully, very happily, always depending on the blessings of Krishna and Balram. And when Draupadi got married in the Swayamvar, Krishna and Balram were also present there. And after Arjun won Draupadi in Swayamvar, Krishna and Balram followed them. And when Vyasdeva came to the house of that potter man where Kunti and the 5 Pandavas were staying and where Draupadi had just come, after Vyasdeva came and spoke all this, even Krishna and Balram came and they blessed Draupadi. And they gave blessings to the 5 brothers to accept Draupadi as their wife. And they also sanctioned the marriage. And then they were living in the forest, and what they would do is at night, they would sleep on the floor. So Mother Kunti would sleep, and then the five brothers would sleep with their heads towards their mother. And at the feet of these five brothers, Mother Draupadi would sleep. Just imagine, on the floor they are sleeping, Kunti is lying down, with their heads towards Kunti, the five brothers are lying down, and towards their feet, across their feet, at their feet, Srimati Draupadi Devi is sleeping. They would lie down on the ground in the forest like this every night, and gazing at the moon and the stars and the night sky, Srimati Kunti Devi would narrate the sweet pastimes of Krishna and Balaram in Vrindavan to her five sons and to her daughter-in-law, Srimati Draupadi Devi. Kunti would tell stories about Krishna. How? Because Kunti was the sister of Krishna's father, Vasudeva. And because one of the wives of Vasudeva, Rohini, was living with Krishna and Balaram in Vrindavan with Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Mai, Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Mai and Krishna Balaram were living with Rohini. Rohini was the wife of Vasudeva. And Vasudeva was the brother of Kunti. So Kunti used to often visit Vrindavan, Gokul Vrindavan, and stay in the house of Nanda Maharaj, Yashoda Mai and Rohini, because she was related to Rohini. And she was the auntie of Krishna and Balaram. She used to stay there in Vrindavan many times. She used to regularly visit them. And therefore she knew the intimate pastimes of Krishna and Balaram, their Balya Leela in Vrindavan. And Kunti used to lovingly narrate these stories to the five Pandavas and to Draupadi, and they would hear with rapt attention and great ecstasy. In fact, the Acharyas explain that the blessed day of Diwali, when Damodar Leela took place in Vrindavan, Srimati Kunti Devi was present there that day. She was visiting Vrindavan, and she with her own eyes saw the Damodar Leela. So Kunti Devi was very exalted, and she used to...
So can you be a little louder?
Sure, Mataji. Is this better?
Yeah, better.
Okay. So Kunti Devi used to narrate these beautiful Krishna Katha, and the five brothers and Draupadi used to hear with rapt attention. Again, it's a long story. I will fast forward. So in this way, then Dhritarashtra came to know that the Pandavas have married the daughter of Drupad. And Maharaj Drupad was almost as powerful as the Kurus. So now Dhritarashtra got scared that, oh, we tried to kill the five brothers and their mother, but they have survived. Not only have they survived, but they have married the daughter of King Drupad, and they have made alliance with the King Drupad Maharaj, who is so powerful. His son is so powerful, Drushtadyumna, that he has been born to kill Dronacharya, who is one of the strongest warriors that I have. In this way, Dhritarashtra became scared. So now I must patch up with the five brothers, Pandavas, otherwise I will be destroyed. So he got very scared. And he sent messengers that, oh, you are alive. We thought you are dead, my dear Pandavas. Please come back home. And he invited them home and he gave them half his kingdom. But the half that he gave was all barren land, khandar. It was called Khandoprastha. There was nothing there except desert and forest. No civilization, nothing. No development. But Yudhishthir Maharaj and his brothers, by the blessings of Krishna and Balaram, they constructed a very nice fort, a nice palace, and the whole kingdom became flourishing. And people from all over the world were coming and residing there under the kingship of Yudhishthir Maharaj at Khandoprastha. It became more opulent than Indraprastha. It became more opulent than the abode of the demigods also, by the blessings of Krishna. And very happily, the five Pandavas, their wife Draupadi, they were living in this Khandoprastha kingdom. And Krishna and Balaram would often time visit them there. And one day, Krishna and Balaram were invited for lunch. They were staying there because they had such good friendship with the five brothers and their wife. Draupadi had Sakhyara with Krishna and Balram. She was their friend and so were her husbands. So one day they were all having prasad, and whenever Krishna Balram used to visit, Draupadi was the queen. And by the blessings of Krishna, Yudhishthira Maharaj had just performed the Rajasuya Yajna, which means he was the undisputed king of the whole planet now. Yudhishthira Maharaj, he was ruling from Khandavaprastha. And Duryodhana and his brothers were burning in jealousy. Shakuni was burning in jealousy. Karna was burning in jealousy. And now Draupadi was the queen of the whole planet, being the wife of Yudhishthira Maharaj. She had so many servants at her beck and call. But she would, with her own loving hands, personally cook every single day for Krishna and Balram and her husbands. So one day she had cooked a beautiful feast, and the five brothers were sitting along with Krishna and Balram, and they were eating their prasad. They were eating prasadam. They were eating happily. And Krishna wanted to eat a fruit, and he wanted to share it with everyone. So Krishna had a respectful relationship with Yudhishthira Maharaj. He used to bow down to him. He had a friendly relationship with Bhima and Arjun. He used to embrace them. And he considered Nakula and Sahadeva as his younger brothers. So they used to offer him respect, and Krishna used to accept their respect. So he decided to eat a fruit and share it with all the five brothers. So he took an apple and he tried to cut it into different pieces so that he could give it everybody and share it with everyone. And as Krishna was cutting the apple with the knife, he cut his own finger. And Krishna's finger started bleeding on the dining table where they were eating. As soon as Mother Draupadi saw that her beloved Krishna's finger has been cut and it is bleeding profusely, Mother Draupadi, without a second thought, she was wearing the most expensive silk sari with valuable precious jewels everywhere. Without a second thought, she tore her sari and rushed to Krishna and immediately wrapped her sari tightly around Krishna's bleeding finger and stopped the bleeding. She did not care about her sari. She did not call for any servants or vaidya. No, this is my Krishna. He has got hurt, he is bleeding. Without a second thought, the queen of the whole planet tore her sari and wrapped it around Krishna's bleeding finger and stopped the bleeding. And Krishna was so grateful to Draupadi Devi for this service. In this way, they were happily passing their time together in the palace of Khandavaprastha. And Duryodhan was burning with jealousy, and he decided to visit and see what is it at Khandavaprastha. What is Yudhishthira Maharaj doing that the population of the whole world is attracted there, and he has become the ruler of the whole world, and he has performed the Rajasuya Yajna also. So Duryodhan comes, and Mayadev has created a sabha in the palace of Yudhishthira Maharaj, which was even better than the court of Indradev in the heavenly planets. It was so amazing. We don't have time to describe everything. But the doors were completely transparent glass. It was illusory, Maya. It used to create such visual illusions that even the smartest fellows would be tricked. And he had a pond within the palace which was covered with Rangoli, colored powder, and he had constructed the pond in such a way that the water would always be full to the brim, yet it would be completely still. No matter how many people walked around, the pond water would not create any ripples. It was completely still. So the Rangoli used to appear as if it's Rangoli on the solid ground. Nobody could make out that there is water under this Rangoli. And Duryodhan and Shakuni very enviously, very haughtily walked into that palace uninvited. They were not even invited, but they came. And as they came, Yudhishthira Maharaj and all the Pandavas They bowed down. Even Krishna and Balram were there. Duryodhan and Shakuni did not acknowledge their respects, and they just walked into the palace. They wanted to see what is it here that everybody is glorifying this assembly of Yudhishthira Maharaj so much. And as Duryodhan and Shakuni walked into the court, Duryodhan mistook the Rangoli to be Rangoli on solid ground. He did not realize that there is a pond underneath the Rangoli decoration. And he walked straight onto it, and splash, he fell down into the pond. And all his royal clothes got colored, got wet, his crown fell down, it was all mess. And up in the balcony of that court, Krishna, Balaram, and all the five Pandava brothers, along with Srimati Draupadi Devi, were standing. And Krishna was the first one to laugh. Why did Krishna laugh? Because Duryodhan had not come there in friendship. He had come there in envy. He had tried to usurp the throne from Yudhishthira Maharaj. He had tried to kill the Pandavas. He had tried to burn them, poison them. So much, he was so full of envy that when he fell down, Krishna was the first person to laugh loudly at Duryodhan. And then Krishna looked at Draupadi and all the Pandavas and encouraged them with his hands, with the gesture of his hands, to also laugh. And then Draupadi also laughed, and Arjun also laughed, and Bhim also laughed loudly. But Yudhishthira Maharaj did not laugh. He ran down from the balcony to where Duryodhan had fallen, and he apologized, and with great humility and respect, he offered his hand to Duryodhan to pick him, to help him out of the pond, out of the water. But Duryodhan did very angrily, growled at Yudhishthir, and instead asked Shakuni for his hand. And he grabbed Shakuni's hand and came out of the pond and walked away, fuming with anger. And similarly, at the Swayamvar ceremony of Draupadi, Karna also wanted to participate. But it is Swayamvar, it is a choice of Draupadi Devi. And she did not want to marry Karna, because she knew that in his previous birth, he was a very wicked Rakshas called Sahasrakavach and Naranarayan Rishi, who were Krishna and Arjun in their previous birth, had killed him. And now he was reborn as Karna. So Draupadi knew his background, that Karna was very demoniac. So she did not want him to participate, and she did not allow him to participate. She said, I will only let Kshatriyas participate. And you are Sutaputra. You are the son of a charioteer. You are not Kshatriya, so you cannot participate. So Karna had gone there with a lusty heart to marry Draupadi, because Draupadi was an expansion of Goddess of Fortune. She was the most beautiful lady. Mahabharata describes that 8 miles radius around Draupadi, her bodily fragrance, her bodily aroma, used to emanate. Her body was always fragrant, like freshly blooming lotus flower. Her hair was beautiful, black, blackish blue, silken. She had dark complexion, like Krishna. And she was so Krishna conscious. Draupadi was so devoted to Krishna right from her birth that she was called Krishna. Everything that we do has an external reason and an internal reason. The external reason is that Draupadi had taken the complexion of Krishna, so she was called Krishna. But the internal reason was that it's not just that she was dark complexion, but she was so devoted to Krishna that from her birth, her name was Krishna. Because she was devoted to Krishna, her name was Krishna. That was Draupadi. So Karna also held a grudge that he was not allowed to participate in the Swayamvar of Draupadi, by Draupadi. So he was also very envious of Arjun. So after this, Duryodhan wanted to take revenge, and he wanted to destroy Khandavaprastha. He wanted to destroy the 5 Pandavas. So they told Dhritarashtra to invite Yudhishthir for a gambling match. knowing that when the father figure invites Yudhishthir, being so devoted to the elders of the family, will never refuse. And he sends Vidur from Hastinapur to Khandavaprastha with the invitation for the gambling. And Yudhishthir immediately is very hesitant, and he tells Vidur, "My dear Vidura, you are like our guru. I don't want to participate in this gambling. Gambling is not good, and I am sure if Kauravas, who are so inimical towards us, if we gamble with them, there will certainly be a fight. It will not be a fair gambling match." Vidur said, "Myself, Bhishma Dev and Dronacharya, we have tried so hard to dissuade Dhritarashtra from hosting this gambling match of dice, but he is not listening. He is completely overcome by the evil intentions of his dear son, Duryodhan, who is the most evil wretch of the Kuru dynasty." So Yudhishthira Maharaj said, "Dhritarashtra is like my father. He is a father figure. If he invites, I cannot refuse. So let us go." So very hesitatingly, against his wishes, Yudhishthir went. And Duryodhan had constructed a special hall, assembly hall, a sabha, for the gambling match. And he had invited kings from all over the world. Hundreds of people had assembled. There was Bhishma Dev, who had also come with great hesitation. There was Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Vidur, Dhritarashtra, the king himself, Duryodhan along with his 99 brothers, Shakuni, Karna, they were all there. And Yudhishthir, Bhim, Arjun, Nakul, Sahadev also arrived. And they told Draupadi to quickly go inside to the female chamber where she would stay with Gandhari. And Yudhishthir Maharaj told Duryodhan that, "Why do you want to engage me in this gambling? I don't want to engage in this. What are you going to get? You are also very rich. I am also very rich. What is the need to gamble? I don't have a desire to earn any more wealth by gambling. And you should also not have any desire to earn any more wealth, because you are already so wealthy. You are the next king of Hastinapur. So you don't need wealth. I don't need wealth. Why should we gamble? It is sinful." In this way, Yudhishthira Maharaj instructs Duryodhan. And Duryodhan tells him, "You are a Kshatriya. If you are challenged, you have to accept it. That is your religion. It's your duty to accept a challenge. If you are afraid, then you need not play. But it is your duty." So just like as physicians, when we get a patient comes in emergency to us, we cannot refuse. It is our duty to accept the patient. Similarly, it was in the Vedic culture 5,000 years ago, the duty of a Kshatriya to accept any challenge that was thrown at them. So Yudhishthira Maharaj said, "Okay, I will play the gambling match with you, with dice." So the way it works is, you put something at stake, like I may put $100 on stake and then roll the dice and throw it. And before I throw it, I have to call out a number, 6. And if something else comes, then I lost. But if 6 comes on the dice, then I won the stake. It's like that. So it was the first. So Duryodhan challenged, and Yudhishthir said, "Okay, I will accept." And when they sat down to play, Duryodhan said, "Okay, I will stake, but on my behalf, Shakuni, my uncle, will throw the dice." So Yudhishthira Maharaj said, "This is unheard of. When we play dice, the person who puts the stake, he has to throw the dice. For example, if I say, I stake my chariot, then I have to throw the dice. Not, I cannot have someone else throw it for me." Because everybody knew that Shakuni was a world champion in dice. He was always gambling every day, and he was very expert. Nobody could beat him in gambling, in the dice game. So Yudhishthira became very scared, very skeptical. No. You challenge me, so you have to play with me. So Duryodhan said, No. Shakuni doesn't have so much wealth to stake in the gambling. So I will provide wealth, but Shakuni is very skilled. So he will throw the dice on my behalf. This was completely unfair. It is like calling someone for a friendly wrestling game and then calling the Olympics gold medal wrestler and saying that, okay, he will fight on my behalf. That was completely unfair. So Yudhishthira Maharaj said, "This is completely unfair. Nobody plays like this." you have to stake and you have to throw the dice, not Shakuni. And then again Duryodhan said, okay, if you are scared, if you are not a true Kshatriya, then you may not play if you are scared. So then Yudhishthir turned towards Dhritarashtra and said, Maharaj Dhritarashtra, you are like my father. I will do whatever you say. I think this is not fair. But what do you think? Do you want me to play? And Dhritarashtra kept quiet, kept silent. And everybody kept silent. And then Duryodhan said, come on, come on. If you want to play, play. If you are scared, then just say that I am scared and go away like a non-Kshatriya. When nobody came to Yudhishthir Maharaja's rescue, he said, okay, I will play. Again, I don't want to go into details, it's a long story. But to cut it short, the game was complete fraud, the dice was loaded, and Shakuni won every single time he threw the dice, and they made Yudhishthir Maharaj lose everything. He lost his four brothers, he lost even himself, and then he said, okay, now let us end the game, I have lost everything. This was when Duryodhan said, well, you have not lost everything. You still have the beautiful Draupadi. And he starts describing the bodily features of Draupadi Devi. You still have Draupadi. She is supposed to be expansion of Goddess of Fortune. So you, why don't you gamble her? She will turn your fortune around and she will win for you and you will regain everything. How can you say that you have nothing more to gamble? You have to gamble her. And against his wishes, again, Yudhishthir Maharaj looked at the elders to stop Duryodhan. But when nobody spoke, Yudhishthir, he gambled, he put Draupadi on stake. And sure enough, the wicked Shakuni won that game also. And then Duryodhan, Dushasan, Karna, Shakuni, they started laughing. And throughout, Dhritarashtra was eagerly asking Vidur, what happened? What happened? Is Draupadi won? Has Draupadi been won? Like that. Because he also wanted Draupadi to be enjoyed by his son. He was so unfairly attached to his son. And when Draupadi was won, then Duryodhan told one of the servants, let go and bring Draupadi. And Draupadi at that time was in seclusion. Mahabharata describes that she was wearing a single cloth and she was not supposed to come out in front of her elders. When she was in seclusion in the women's chamber, and the servant went there with a messenger, as a messenger, and told her everything that had happened. So he said, you have been lost, you are a slave of Duryodhan, and he's calling you in the Kuru Sabha, in the Kuru court, he's calling you in front of hundreds and hundreds of people. So Draupadi said, I am not supposed to go out in public during this period of the during this time, and therefore I am in seclusion, my hair is not tied, and I cannot go like this. Besides, didn't Yudhishthir have anything else to put on stake? Why did he stake his wife? Who puts their own wife on stake in the dice game? This is unheard of. So the servant says that no, he staked everything else, and when he had lost everything, including himself, then he staked you. So Draupadi, being such an intelligent lady, she said, but if Yudhishthir had already lost himself, then what right did he have to stake me? Well, I didn't belong to him. He had already lost himself. Go and ask this question to all the elders in the Kuru Sabha. So the servant comes back to the court and tells that Draupadi is asking this question. And nobody answers. And Duryodhan says, he chastises the servant, you foolish person, don't come back without getting Draupadi. Go and bring her. And again, he goes back to Draupadi. And again, he tells Draupadi that you are called there. They don't care what you say. They are not willing to answer your question. So then Draupadi says, okay, my dear servant. And Draupadi feels pain for the servant, because the servant has to come back and forth. And Draupadi, being such a wonderful Vaishnavi, she understands that the servant is also tormented in his heart, having to do such a difficult service. So she feels compassion on him. And she said, I'm so sorry to put you through this, but please go and ask the Kuru elders that King Dhritarashtra, ask Bhishmadev, ask Dronacharya, that is this fair to force a woman to appear in the assembly of men is this fair? If they say, if the Kuru elders say, yes, this is fair, then I will come. So again, the servant goes back and he poses the question of Draupadi to the Kuru elders. And this time, Duryodhan becomes very livid. So he and Karna, they tell Dushasan, Dushasan, this servant is useless. He's a foolish person. You go and forcefully drag Draupadi into the Kuru Sabha right now. And then Dushasan becomes very happy. He jumps up from his seat and very happily goes to the women's chamber where Draupadi is. He goes and he tells Draupadi, oh Draupadi, you are no longer the queen of the world. Your husbands are our slaves and you are also our slaves. You are also our slaves. Now come, we are going to engage you in menial service in front of everybody in the Kuru Sabha. Come with me. And Draupadi tells him that Dushasan, you are like my child. You are the younger brother of Yudhishthir Maharaj. Please do not talk like that. Don't you know that I am a devotee of Krishna? Don't you know that I am a dear friend of Krishna? If you treat me like this, if you violate the chastity of a woman like this, I am chaste to my husbands. If you violate my modesty like this, severe sins will come upon you and your whole dynasty will be destroyed, Dushasan. Please do not do this. And Dushasan laughs. He said, Krishna, you are a friend of Krishna. Krishna is not here. Krishna is in Dwarka, which is hundreds of miles away. What is Krishna going to do? You are our slave and you come right now with me. Saying this, Dushasan charges towards the poor, saintly woman, Draupadi Devi. Draupadi Devi is very, very slim, very tender. She's a beautiful young princess. She was born from Yajna. She did not even have a material birth. Then she was brought up by Drupad Maharaj. Nobody could see Draupadi. She was so well protected and cared for. And after marriage, she was always under the loving protection of her five husbands and Kunti Devi. And now, here is Dushasan charging towards Draupadi. Draupadi says, I am going to the chamber of your mother, Gandhari Devi, right now. And Draupadi starts running towards Gandhari's room in the woman's chamber. Dushasan runs towards Draupadi with greater speed, not wanting her to go to his mother, and grabs Draupadi by her beautiful hair and drags her forcefully, violently into the Kuru Sabha, where Dhritarashtra, Bhishmadev, Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Vidur, the five Pandavas, the 100 Kaurav brothers, Shakuni, Karna, and so many ministers, so many visiting kings and princes from all over the world are present. So many servants are present. In front of them, Draupadi, who was the queen of the entire planet, completely chaste wife to five most powerful men on planet, was dragged helplessly. Draupadi petitioned her husband that, please see what Dushasan is doing to me. Please help me. Please save me. And all her five husbands are sitting helplessly with eyes downcast, staring at the ground. They were beside themselves in anger, but they could not do anything. Draupadi asked King Dhritarashtra, who was the chief of the Kuru Sabha, being the king. She asked him, is this dharmic, what your son is doing? Is this how a lady is to be treated by the Kurus, the great dynasty of Kurus? And Dhritarashtra kept silent.
Then Duryodhan started insulting Draupadi. He said, "You are our slave. You are our slave. You have to engage in our service and do what we want you to do." And Draupadi again reminded Duryodhan of Dharma. She said, "Women are always to be protected and respected. You cannot treat me like this. I am a friend of Krishna. Great calamity will befall you and your family if you do this." And Duryodhan laughs and makes fun of Draupadi. And then Duryodhan tries to play Draupadi against her own husband. He says, "Okay, Draupadi, if you tell me that your husband Yudhishthir was insane, was unjust, was cruel in having gambled you off in the game of gambling, if you say that he is adharmic, then I will let you go." But Draupadi was chaste to her husband. She would never say anything like that. She said, "This whole gambling game was rigged. My husband never wanted to play in the first place. Second of all, to convince him to play, you told him that this is a friendly game. And now you are doing this to me? What is my husband's fault? It is yours and Shakuni's fault." When Draupadi spoke like this, Karna got up and he said, "My dear friend Duryodhan, just look at this Draupadi." Now Karna wanted to settle his own score against Draupadi. He said, "She is your slave. We can do whatever we want. She is not a queen anymore and her husbands are not kings anymore. Remove your garments." Karna tells the five Pandava brothers. And obediently the five Pandava brothers, they remove their upper garments, upavastras. And they are sitting with their eyes downcast. And then Karna tells Draupadi, "You have already married these five men. What is the harm if you marry 100 more men? You are the slave of Duryodhan and his 99 brothers. And we want to see you naked. We want to see your naked beauty right now. Dushasan, disrobe Draupadi. Remove her sari right now." And Dushasan, very happily, he again goes towards Draupadi and he grabs hold of her sari. And Draupadi, with both her hands helplessly, afraid, like a helpless deer who has been caught by a vicious lion, with both her tender, slender hands, she held on to her sari and begged all the Kuru elders and begged her husbands to please help her. She petitioned Dushasan not to go ahead with this heinous crime. But Dushasan laughed and he started pulling vigorously at Draupadi's sari. With her own strength, Draupadi tried to save herself. She begged her husbands to save her. They could not help. She begged the Kuru elders to save her and reminded them of the principles of Dharma, but they could not help her. Bhishmadev, Dronacharya and Vidur, they were looking down at the ground and they were sobbing. The Mahabharata specifically describes that Bhishmadev, the senior most member of the Kuru clan, was weeping and wailing like a small baby. He could not believe what Duryodhan and Dushasan and Karna were about to do. But he was helpless because nobody in a king's sabha can override the king. Only Dhritarashtra could have stopped this. But Dhritarashtra, being spiritually blind, being morally blind, kept his mouth shut. Some people say that Draupadi deserved this because she laughed at Duryodhan when he fell in the Maya Sabha in Khandavaprastha. But that is not true. That is not true. In the Mahabharata serial, they show things like Draupadi saying, "Andhe ka beta andha, oh, the son of a blind man is also blind. Look how he fell down." In the original Mahabharata by Vyasdeva, nothing like this is mentioned. Draupadi never spoke like this. That's all Bollywood fiction. Krishna laughed and Krishna encouraged them to laugh, and therefore Draupadi laughed. And she laughed because Duryodhan deserved it. But anyway, even if a devotee commits mistakes, a devotee's attitude is always Aparada sahasrani kriyante harnisham maya daso ham iti manmatva shamasva madhusudana. Aparada sahasrani kriyante ham. I have done thousands of aparadas. Dasoham itiman matva. But please consider me as your servant. Kshamasva Madhusudana. And please, if you so desire, O Madhusudana, please forgive my thousands of aparadas. Mistakes happen from everyone. But a devotee is always humble and begs forgiveness from Krishna. And Krishna, out of his own sweet will, forgives his devotees, even if they make a mistake. But Draupadi had not committed any mistake.
And then Dushasan started pulling at her sari. And when nobody could help her,
Draupadi raised her hands. She let go of her sari and she chanted three verses, which are the verses that we chanted in the beginning of the class. These are the words spoken by a pure devotee of Krishna, Srimati Draupadi Devi, in the Kuru Sabha, when in front of Duryodhan, Karna, Shakuni, the 99 lusty brothers of Duryodhan, all the kings, her husbands, Kuru, respectable elders like Dhritarashtra, Bhishma Dev, Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Vidur, in front of all of them, in front of the male servants who were serving in the court, in front of all of them, Dushasan was about to strip Draupadi Devi naked and expose her in front of everyone. In such a helpless, desperate situation, Srimati Draupadi Devi chanted these three prayers. And these three prayers I would like to discuss and then end the class. These are the words spoken by Draupadi Devi herself. Very, very powerful prayers. She gave up her sari, raised her hands and chanted these prayers. Govinda Dwaraka Vasi Krishna Gopi Jana Priya Tauravair Paribhutan Maam Kimna Jana Sikeshava. He Nath He Ramanatha Vrajanath Artinashanam Kauravai Navabhugnanma Uddharasva Janardana. Krishna Krishna Mahayogin Vishwatman Vishwabhavana Prapannam Pahi Govinda Guru Madhe Vashidatin. Govinda Dwaraka Vasin. Govinda, you are Dwaraka Vasin. You are residing in Dwaraka. I am here in Hastinapur. You are miles away in Dwaraka. Govinda Dwaraka Vasin. Krishna Gopi Jana Priya. O Krishna, you are very, very dear to the gopis of Vrindavan. Krishna Gopi Jana Priya, you are very dear to the Vraja Gopis. Kauravair Paribhutan Maam. I am being humiliated by the Kaurava. Kauravair Paribhutan Maam. Kimna Jana Sikeshava. What is it that you don't know? Kimna Jana Sikeshava. Oh my dear Keshava. What is it that you don't know? You know I am being humiliated here in the Kuru Sabha right now. He Nath, He Ramanath. O Lord of Mother Lakshmi. He Nath, He Ramanath. Rama is the name of Lakshmi Devi. He Nath, He Ramanath. Vrajanath Artinashanam. Vrajanath, you are the lord of Vraja, Vrindavan. Just see, in this helpless situation, in this pathetic situation, Draupadi Devi is able to remember Vrindavan. She is remembering the Vraja Gopis. Vrajanath Artinashanam. Arti means calamity. Nashanam means you destroyed all the calamities that came on Vraja. Whether it was Putana or Trinavrat or Bakasur, Aghasur. You destroyed all the calamities that came on Vrindavan. Vrajanath Artinashanam. Kauravair Namabhugnanma. These Kauravas are dragging me down. These Kauravas are drowning me, pushing me down. Uddharasva Janardhanam. Oh my dear Janardhan, Uddharasva Janardhanam. Please lift me up. The Kauravas are pulling me down. Please lift me up, oh Janardhan, oh maintainer of all living entities, Janardhan. And then Draupadi Devi's prayers reached a crescendo. Krishna Krishna Maha Yogin. Krishna Krishna, you are Mahayogi, you are Yogeshwar, you are the lord of all mystics. Krishna Krishna Maha Yogin Vishwatman Vishwa Bhavana. Vishwatman, you are the Vishwa Atma, you are the Paramatma, you are the Super Soul, you are the lord of this whole universe. Vishwa Bhavana, you are the creator of this whole universe. Prapannam Pahi Govinda. Prapannam means to surrender. I am surrendering unto you, O Krishna. Pahi Govinda. And please take care of me, O Govinda. Prapannam Pahi Govinda. Kuru Madhe Vashidakim. I am drowning in the ocean of Gurus. Dushasan, Duryodhan, their 98 lusty brothers, the lusty eyes of Karna, Shakuni, I am drowning in the ocean of Gurus. Pahi Govinda. Prapannam Pahi Govinda. Guru Madhe Vashidatin. She offered this heartfelt prayer and Dushasan started pulling her sari. When Dushasan grabbed her hair and pulled her sari and humiliated her in front of so many respectable people, Draupadi was ready to give up her life. You see, Mother Sita in her previous life was Vedavati. And when Ravan grabbed her hair, by her mystic power, she converted her hand into a sword, chopped off her hair, freed herself from the grip of Ravan by cutting off her hair, and with her own mystic power, consumed her whole body into fire and left her body. You know that story. Similarly, Draupadi Devi had appeared from fire. When she was humiliated and insulted in such a way, and her hair was grabbed and she was pushed and shoved forcefully, and her single sari was being pulled in front of so many lusty men, Draupadi was ready to give up her life. But she did not give up her life. And there is a very deep reason for this. Draupadi could have given up her life when insulted, but she did not give up her life simply because for the sake of Krishna. What will people think that Krishna did not protect Draupadi and Draupadi had to give up her life? Krishna failed to protect Draupadi? Why is his name Achyut? Because he is infallible. He never fails to protect his devotees. The only reason Draupadi did not give up her life air is for the sake of Krishna's reputation. That people should not criticize my Krishna that he could not protect his devotee, Draupadi, who was so devoted to him that her name was Krishna. So Draupadi prays, Pratigya Tava Govinda. Nindana me bhakta pranashyati iti samsmritya samsmritya pranam dharyam mamyaham. Pratigya tava govinda. Oh govinda, it is your pratigya, it is your vow, it is your promise. Name bhakta pranashyati. My devotee shall not perish. This is not a promise that Krishna gave 5,000 years ago in Bhagavad Gita. This is Krishna's eternal promise. Draupadi already knew. This is Krishna's eternal promise. Pratigya tava govinda name bhakta pranashyati iti samsmritya samsmritya. I am again and again remembering this pratigya of yours, O Govinda. I am remembering your promise. Pranam dharyam mamaham. And I am holding on to my pran. I am holding on to my life here. I am not giving up my life. Just simply remembering this promise that you will protect me, O Govinda. I will not give up my life. So what will people think? That Achyut failed to protect Draupadi and she was holding on to her life. And Dushyasana started pulling her hard. And he was pulling on her sari so hard that she was spinning. As Dushyasana was pulling her sari, Draupadi was spinning. But as Draupadi offered these prayers to Krishna, Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna was sitting on his throne in Dwarka. But he heard Draupadi's piteous cries. He heard Draupadi's heartfelt prayers loud and clear in Dwarka. And as soon as Draupadi called him, Prapannam Pahi Govinda Guru Madhe Vashidatim. As soon as Draupadi called him, within a moment, Krishna left what he was doing in Dwarka and rushed to the Kuru Sabha in Hastinapur. Unseen by anybody, within a moment, in less than a moment, Bhakta Vatsal Krishna was present in the Kuru Sabha. And he took Janma, he took birth, Janmashtami. He took birth as a sari. And he became Draupadi's sari. His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj, in his new book, The Journey Within, he describes this powerful pastime. Krishna incarnated as Draupadi's sari. He became Draupadi's sari. And Dushyasana was pulling the sari. And Draupadi was spinning. And she was, with her eyes closed, her hands raised, she was praying to Krishna. And all Draupadi could feel was the loving, warm embrace of her beloved Krishna. Because Krishna had become that sari which was wrapped around Draupadi's divine body. So Draupadi could only feel Krishna's loving embrace, tight, warm embrace, loving embrace of Krishna in the Kuru Sabha. That is all Draupadi could feel. And all Dushyasana could feel was an unlimited sari that keeps on elongating. He pulled and he pulled and he pulled and he pulled with his kshatriya strong arms, kept pulling. But the sari did not end. The whole Kuru Sabha was covered with sari. A big mountain of sari was created. Dushyasana kept pulling hard, laboring hard. Shrama eva hi kevalam. But nothing he could do, nothing in his strength could disrobe Draupadi. Krishna protected Draupadi. Avashya rakhi ve Krishna. Draupadi was completely protected by Krishna and nobody could see her naked. Nobody could disrobe her. As the sari kept on elongating, everyone in the Kuru Sabha started applauding Draupadi. Draupadi is such a pure devotee of Krishna. She's so chaste that she cannot be disrobed. Just see the miracle. Her sari is limitless. And look at Dushyasana. He is exhausted and he has collapsed on the ground. Completely exhausted. And Dushyasana looked at Duryodhana and said, I cannot do it, my brother. This is impossible. And he fell down with beads of perspiration on his face. Completely exhausted. And then Duryodhan did not stop his insults. He moved aside his dhoti and he exposed his thigh and started patting his thigh. And Draupadi, who was standing helplessly in the Kuru Sabha, Duryodhan told Draupadi that, "Draupadi, come, come, don't worry, come." He started patting his lap. "Come, sit on my lap. You are my dasi now. Come, sit on my lap." At this point, the line had been crossed. The line had been crossed. It's a long story. I'll conclude now. We'll fast forward. There is much to discuss, but unfortunately we cannot. But we'll fast forward. 13 years later, after the Vanvas was finished and the Kurukshetra war was taking place, Krishna destroyed Karna, who had called Draupadi a prostitute and who had suggested that she be disrobed. He destroyed Dushasan, who grabbed Draupadi's hair and sari, and he destroyed Duryodhan, who had patted his thigh and exposed his thigh to a chaste lady like Draupadi. But Krishna destroyed them by unfair tactics, apparently unfair tactics, deliberately. Why? In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, "Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam tathaiva bhajamyaham." As you approach me, I reciprocate accordingly. Duryodhan and Dushasan approached with cheating. They poisoned the food, they burned the house when the Pandavas are sleeping. This is all cheating. So they cheated. And in Gita, Krishna says, among the cheaters, I am the greatest cheat. So Krishna also cheated them. He made Bhim kill Dushasan. And when Bhim caught hold of Dushasan, Bhim was so angry. He remembered how Dushasan had caught hold of Draupadi's hair and pulled her sari. He said, "Dushasan, tell me, with which hand did you hold Draupadi's beautiful hair? Tell me." And Dushasan was so proud. He said, "Here, this hand." And Bhim pushed him down on the ground, put his leg in the armpit of Dushasan, and with his hand he grabbed the hand of Dushasan with which Dushasan had pulled Draupadi's hair, and Bhim with all his strength uprooted and plucked out the hand of Dushasan from his body. And Dushasan cried in pain, and Bhim started pounding on his chest, and with his bare hands he ripped open the chest of Dushasan, and he pulled out his heart and started drinking the blood from the chest of Dushasan. Now, Bhim is a Vaishnava. He only eats prasad. But here he is drinking the blood from Dushasan's chest and became very satisfied. And not only that, he started mutilating the body, the dead body of Dushasan. And the Kshatriya code is that after you kill your opponent, you don't mutilate the body. But Bhim started dancing around the dead body of Dushasan. And all this was approved by Krishna. And Karna, his chariot wheel was stuck in the ground. Stuck in the mud. Actually, Karna's chariot was stuck in his own karma. And Krishna told Arjun, "Shoot the arrow." And that kantha, that throat from which the words came out that Draupadi is a Vaishya and Draupadi should be stripped naked in the Kuru Sabha, that throat from which these wicked words came out, chop off that throat, Arjun. Chop it off. And Arjun obediently released the arrow and chopped off Karna's neck when Karna was trying to extricate his chariot from the mud. Unfair, right? But no, this was Krishna's reciprocation, because the Kauravas also first approached with cheating. So Krishna is reciprocating with cheating. And Duryodhan, the fighting codes are, you never hit below the belt in a mace fight. But Krishna told Bhim to smash the thigh of Duryodhan, that same thigh which he had exposed in front of Draupadi, that same thigh which he had lustily patted and invited Draupadi to sit on. Krishna asked Bhim to smash that thigh, and Bhim happily complied. And Duryodhan's thigh was smashed, and he died a painful death on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. his face covered with dust. That is Krishna's reciprocation. Avashya Rakhi Bhai Krishna. And we yesterday celebrated Prabhupada's appearance day. Same thing in Juhu temple when Prabhupada was there. Srila Prabhupada purchased the Hare Krishna land in Juhu. And he was building the Juhu temple. There was so much opposition. Mr. Nair, Mrs. Nair, so many gundas came. There was so much opposition. But Prabhupada never sold that land. He fought for it. And after he won the fight and the temple was built, he relaxed and he said that was a good fight. Externally, if we see, again, there is external and internal reasons. Externally, if we see that, yes, Bombay is an important city, we should have a, ISKCON should have a nice temple there, a nice preaching center. That's why Prabhupada wanted a temple in Juhu, Bombay. Bombay is Prabhupada's office, this and that. This is all external reason. There is an internal reason why Prabhupada so vigorously, so relentlessly fought for the Hare Krishna land in Juhu, Bombay. And the reason is, when it was just a land with grass and no construction, no building there, the most merciful Shri Radharas Bihari came to Hare Krishna land. And in a small makeshift tent, Srila Prabhupada and Giriraj Maharaj and Kamal Krishna Goswami, they were worshipping Radha Rasi Hari there in the Hare Krishna land. At that time, Srila Prabhupada had made a promise, standing with folded hands in front of Shri Radharas Bihari. Thank you so much, Shri Radharas Bihari, for coming here. We don't have a temple here for you. We have nothing, just rats, no flowing water, tall grass, cockroaches. But still you have come here to accept service from us. Please stay here. And I promise you, very soon I will build a beautiful temple just for you, right here, and serve you with all opulence. This was a pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada's personal promise to Shri Radharas Bihari. That is why Srila Prabhupada fought so hard for that land. And his desire has been fulfilled. Today, Shri Radharas Bihari are living majestically on Hare Krishna land in a beautiful temple, being served very opulently. Similarly, when Draupadi was humiliated like this, Krishna had made her a personal promise that, my dear Draupadi, I will avenge your humiliation. And therefore, when Arjun did not want to fight the battle of Kurukshetra, Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita. He was so persuasive that he convinced Arjun to fight. And Krishna took revenge from Duryodhan, Shakuni, Dushasan, and Karna. Avashya Rakhi Bhai Krishna. So Krishna will come in our life also if with complete faith, surrender, we also call out to Krishna in the mood of Draupadi and Srila Prabhupada. People say that first Draupadi tried to save herself with her own strength. She prayed to her husband, they could not help. She prayed to the elders, they could not help. And then finally she called Krishna. That is okay, that is a leela. Krishna puts his pure devotees like Draupadi through these terrible trials just to teach us a lesson so that we can learn from his pure devotees. Because when so much churning goes on, the makhan of beautiful prayers come out from the hearts of the pure devotees. Just like you have to churn buttermilk to get makhan. And then from makhan, you can offer Krishna his makhan chor. So similarly, Krishna puts his devotees through churning of trials and tribulations so that the makhan of spiritual realizations, prayers, comes out. Same thing happened with Gajendra also. In Bhagavatam, we see every time when devotees go through difficulties, beautiful prayers come out. Prahlad Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj. So many examples are there. Even Draupadi Devi. So Draupadi, Bilwa Mangal Thakur explains that Draupadi from the beginning was praying to Krishna. It's not like she prayed to everybody and then nobody could help her and then she turned to Krishna. Draupadi was a pure devotee. From the beginning, she was praying to Krishna. Bilwa Mangal Thakur writes in his Govinda Damodar Sotra that Agre Kuruna Matha Pandavanam Dushasanena Rutavas सहस्रकेश कृष्णा तदाक्रो शदनन्यनाथ गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति दैट अग्रे कुरुवा अथ पांडव इन फ्रंट ऑफ पांडवाज एंड कुरु दुशासन ऋत वस्त्र केश व्हेन ही ग्रैब्ड द हेयर एंड द सारी ऑफ द्रौपदी कृष्णा कृष्णा मीन द्रौपदी कृष्णा तदाक्रोशद अनन्यनाथ हैविंग नो अदर लॉर्ड द्रौपदी कॉल्ड आउट गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति बट नॉट ओनली दैट दिलो मंगल ठाकुर फर्दर से दुर्वार वाक्यम परिगृह कृष्ण मृगीव भीता तु कथन कथचित सभां प्रविष्टां मनसा जुहाव गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति दुर्वार वाक्यम आफ्टर द हॉरिबल वाक्य स्पोकन बाय कर्ण एंड दुर्योधन ओबेइंग देयर दुर्वार वाक्यम एंड दुशासन वेंट परिगृही कृष्णा टू कृष्णा कृष्णा मीन्स द्रौपदी ही वेंट इन द गृह ऑफ कृष्णा द फीमेल चेंबर वेयर द्रौपदी वॉज एंड देन ही वेंट देयर दुर्वार वाक्यम परिगृह कृष्णा मृगीव भीता तु कथन कथचित एट दैट टाइम द्रौपदी वॉज स्केर्ड जस्ट लाइक अ डियर अ डो वुड गेट स्केर्ड इन द ग्रैप ऑफ अ लायन एंड सभां प्रविष्टा मनसा जुहाव गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति दैट एज सून एज शी एंटर्ड द सभा सभां प्रविष्टा एज सून एज शी एंटर्ड प्रविष्टा मीन्स टू एंटर सभां प्रविष्टा मनसा जुहाव एज सून एज शी एंटर्ड द कुरु सभा इन हर माइंड मनसा जुहाव शी क्राइड आउट गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति श्री कृष्ण गोविंद हरे मुरारे हे नाथ नारायण वासुदेवा युहेति बस्वा मृतमेत एव गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति तो द्रौपदी प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड फ्रॉम द बिगिनिंग शी वाज प्रेइंग टू कृष्ण It's not like she prayed only in the end when nothing else worked. That was not Draupadi.
Draupadi was a pure devotee. So all glories to Draupadi. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to your wonderful service. You had us all mesmerized, completely mesmerized. Beautiful meditation on the whole mercy of Krishna, how he protects his devotees. Thank you. And your chanting of the verses, all the verses, was just beautiful. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji, for encouraging me. I'm very sorry to go over
Hare Krishna, Adi Gadadhar, Prabhu, Vandita, Prabhupada, and Guru. As this was a wonderful class, like our grandma is taking us in that Leela. So wonderful class, my Gopinath, Mercy, Prabhuji, and you explained, yes, that Mataji told, Jivai to Paswa, Mritame, Vadeva, Govinda, Dama, Dharma, Dharma, Gopinath. Thank you very much, Dhanavad.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Can you share the three verses that you had chanted, that Draupadi was chanting?
Yes, Mataji.
With Preeti Mataji, no, no, no. We shall send it out to us. Thank you, Prabhu.
Yes, I'll send it to Preeti Mataji. These are from the Sabha Parva of the Mahabharata. I will
okay.
Send the three verses.
Yes, thank you, Prabhu. And then also the last ones from the Dhamma, from Bila Mangala Thakur's.
Sure, I will send those also.
Thank you so much, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know that, you know, we're way over time, but this thing about the fact that Draupadi, she did not call out to Krishna as a last resort. She cried out to him from the beginning, according to Bilva Mangala Thakur. So how is it, how did we reconcile these contradictory renderings of this story.
No, there is no contradiction. So, as a wife, in the physical presence of her husbands, it was Draupadi's duty to
ask them for help, to give them a chance to help her. In the presence of her elders of her family, like Dhritarashtra, Bhishma Dev, Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Vidur,
it was her duty to beg them also to protect her.
Mm-hmm.
But right. Internally she was always praying to Krishna.
So we learn from Bhagavad Gita that we have to do our duty also, do our karma, our duty, and at the same time we have to pray also. So externally she was doing all her duty. She was trying with her own strength, prayed to her husbands, prayed to the elders, but internally, throughout from the beginning, she was praying to Krishna. Tabham pravishtha manasa juham. So she did nothing wrong. It was a duty. For example, when a patient comes to me, I give them the medicine, I investigate, I make a diagnosis, but at the same time I depend on Krishna
to cure the patient. So I have to do my duty and then Krishna helps. There are two things, endeavor and mercy. We have to make our endeavor
and then Krishna will give his mercy. The two fingers of Damodar Leela. Same thing, Draupadi did her endeavors, at the same time she depended completely, complete surrender on the mercy of Krishna.
I hope that helps.
It does. It does. But I just can't help but ask this. This one last thing. The fact that Bhishma, that great warrior Kshatriya, he cried like a baby in front of that whole assembly. Is that so?
Absolutely. The original Mahabharata of Vyasadeva, it mentions that
He was crying like a small child. He could not take it anymore, especially when they started disrobing her. Bhishma Dev was crying. Even Dronacharya was crying. Dronacharya was such a big teacher of martial, you know, warfare. He was crying and Vidur was crying. But they did not have the power or authority to overrule the king. The king was presiding over the Sabha. So the king had to stop. It was Dhritarashtra's fault.
But actually, when I was meditating on this, now this is just my meditation.
I'm sorry to share my personal meditation, but Hare Krishna. But when I was meditating on this last time, and I was asking that Krishna, why did you not become visible to everybody? Why only Draupadi could feel your warm and loving embrace because you became her sari? Why did Yudhishthira Maharaj not see you? Why did other people not see you? Why did Bhishma Dev not see you in the Kuru Sabha when you appeared? Nobody knew that Krishna came. They just knew that Draupadi prayed and she was protected.
So I was asking Krishna, why did you come invisible?
Why did you come invisible like this? Why did you become invisible in the Kuru Sabha? This morning when I was worshipping my Shaligram Shilas, I was doing this. I was praying like this to Krishna. Because when Shishupal criticized Krishna in the Rajasya Yajna, then Krishna, in front of everybody, he took out his Sudarshan Chakra and he killed Shishupal. So similarly, when Draupadi called him, Krishna could have appeared there and he could have killed Dushasan in front of everybody. But why did Krishna come in an invisible form? And this is just my meditation, devotees, I may be wrong, but very humbly I would submit that the realization I got from Guru and Krishna this morning was that Krishna was so upset with everybody, that these rules that the Sabha is being presided by the king, these are all formalities. These are all social rules. But when a helpless lady is being assaulted, it is the moral duty of all Kshatriyas, of everybody, to intervene. But Bhishma Dev sat there paralyzed, Dronacharya sat paralyzed, Kripacharya sat paralyzed, everybody sat paralyzed. The brothers also, Bhim almost jumped up from his seat and he said, I will crush these 100 brothers right now. And Arjun, you kill Karna. Let us kill them right now. But Yudhishthira held them back. He said, no, we are slaves. In the presence of our elders, we have to wait for the elders to give us direction. We cannot take law in our own hands. So in this, Yudhishthira controlled them. But when Draupadi was being helplessly assaulted, these people sat there silent And my realization was that Krishna was so upset that he did not want to give his blessed darshan to anyone. He did not want anybody to see him. He did not want to see anybody. He just wanted to take care of his beloved Draupadi at that time.
I'm sorry for having said this, but this was just my understanding. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Adi Gadadhar Prabhu, members of Pranam. Thank you very much for wonderful class. Jai Shri Radhe. Shri Shri Radha Padmanabhi Jai.
Hare Krishna, Dandavat Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu, Dandavat Pranam. Such a beautiful class. You just kept us fixed in our places. Like Praneshwari Mataji was saying, it was so, so beautiful. We were totally, you know, just listening to you for the entire time. It just didn't feel like it's 1.5 hours. It just didn't feel like that. It was so fast. And I really liked the entire storytelling of Mahabharata. It was so beautiful. And then especially the prayers of Draupadi, the way you chanted it and the way you elaborated the meaning, it was so beautiful. And I really liked one point you were making towards the end when you were talking about Krishna. Krishna won over the Kauravas by means of deceit. So why did he do that? You said so beautifully, Yeyata Mam Pratipadyante Tam Sataiva Vajamyam. So however you approach me, I reciprocate accordingly. So that was a very sweet, subtle, very nice explanation. Very, very beautiful, of course, how Krishna appeared as the sari, has written by Radhanath Swami Maharaj. So many beautiful things. It was so beautiful. And the realization you shared indeed was very, very nice towards the end. In fact, even I was listening to one lecture where the speaker was talking about how when Draupadi called out to Krishna, immediately she became the property of Krishna. So it was the very duty of the husbands or whoever was there, including Bhishma, Vidura, everybody, to immediately understand that Draupadi now is the property of Krishna. In the sense, she is a devotee of Krishna, so they should not remain silent, you know. Now, when something is Krishna's, it is your first duty to give protection. So Krishna was a little upset about the whole thing and he didn't appear in front, because in spite of knowing that she's now completely Krishna's, they didn't, in spite of that, they didn't respond. So this is something I heard, so I thought, you know, I'll also share what I heard. So very, very nice, very beautiful realizations, and it's so nice to listen to you, Prabhu. Very nice.
Thank you, Prithivilasimha.
I'm feeling...
thank you. It makes me feel better as well. I thought I must have spoken something. Usually, you know, we just repeat words of our acharyas. We don't speculate. But that
yes.
makes me feel justified. Thank you, Madhuri. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you. Your realization was perfect. Of course, you were in a perfect environment. You were worshipping your Srila. So why would the realization go wrong? Very wonderful. And really, I thank everyone for so nicely still sitting in the class and listening. We have all the speakers on the call, all the listeners on the call still engaged. So that is so nice. Thanks to all the callers for so sincerely logging in every day and listening so nicely. Thank you all so much again.
We were completely mesmerized, Bhishma.
Yeah.
We couldn't move. It was like we become stone. So, it is the glories of Krishna Leela and the wonderful devotees that are narrating them that we were stone-like and mesmerized.
Actually, my mother-in-law sitting next to me, she was the one who didn't move even for a second. At least I was going around. My mother-in-law was like really stuck to the phone. She was like holding the phone really tight next to her. Very, very nice. Very nice.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji, and thank you to all the Matajis who brought Prabhuji to the call. Really mesmerizing lecture, and you took us a virtual tour to the Mahabharata. Thank you so much, Prabhuji, for giving your association.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
I'm always your servant. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.
Okay. So thank you all so much again. If no one else has any comments or questions, we can end the call. Vancha kalpataru vyascha kripa sindhu devacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha ananta koti vaishnavrinda ki jai namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur ki jai Srila Vyas Dev ki jai Sri Sri Krishna ki jai Draupadi ki jai all glories to the assembled devotees His Grace Adi Gadadhar Prabhu ki jai
Prabhupada ki jai thank you
thank you Hare Krishna
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.